For how long I remember when I started vlogging on YouTube, there was a sense of community. And one of the fellow vlogger that was there from the very beginning I was there, I don't remember if he came a little bit before me or a little bit after me, I don't remember, but it seems like Shonner was always there. And throughout the years, he's been very constant in his vlogging, but the style changed a lot and a lot of stuff happened. And it was an interesting evolution to watch over the years. So today it's with a great pleasure that I have with me as a guest, Shauna, who I've been friend with for a long time in the RPG community on YouTube. And I'd like to start this podcast, just asking you, like, who are you? How do you started role-playing games? And why do you role-play in general? So who are you, Shonner?
My name is Sean Driscoll. I was born in the 60s, grew up in the 70s, pretty much high school, that kind of thing. That's when D&D, AD&D first edition was out, late 70s. Playing D&D with high school kids from the cafeteria. And we were playing it wrong, of course. Because we didn't know what we were doing. We would have a half hour game, so that tells you we were doing it wrong. Because lunch was like an hour. But the dungeon master would draw a quick map on a grid, on a sheet of grid paper, and we would just play on that. We'd look at the map, we all saw the map while we were playing on it. Rolling the dice. We didn't have minis, so we're using our pennies and dimes for minis. And the whole time I'm thinking, this could be put on a computer. So that's what I started doing, was making games like Rogue for home computers. The computer generates the dungeons, and you use the arrow keys to move your character around in a maze, fighting monsters. There's probably a billion of those programs now on any old computer, even on the phones now.
That's interesting.
Now you asked why I role play. Well, I didn't think of that. I just thought of that as board gaming at the time. But
Makes sense.
in college, I was invited over to a friend's house. He was going to run D&D. And this was like maybe 3 or 4 years later after high school. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, oh no, it's going to be more maps, more rolling dice every time. It's just combat session, combat, combat, combat. But when I showed up, there was no table in the guy's living room, no coffee table or anything. And we're all just sitting in chairs and sofas. And he had the die in his hand. And some sort of a folder that he would roll the thing on. We'd roll it on. And he would say, just tell me where your character is and what your character's doing. And that's how we played. It was the most amazing game ever. And he only had us roll dice when something extremely important was going to come up. Something that was life altering, something that would make things super, super interesting. And he didn't just outright kill us if we failed. He just made the task that much harder to do if we failed a roll. We were going to have to take the long way to go through the quest instead of the easy way. So it was very interesting. And I got spoiled by that game session. I thought, this is so neat. This is how it's done.
Kind of like an enlightenment, an
Yeah.
epiphany, some kind of an epiphany.
So for a couple or maybe 2 or 3 years after that, I was always like, oh, sure, I'll be in your game, because I role played once, so I want to do it again. But every time I'd go into someone's game, it would just be this, you know, let's be on the board with our minis and do combat. Nothing about no role play, nothing interesting happening with the characters, just killing monsters. It's like I would think, okay, why was my character spawned in this dungeon or this forest or the desert? Why am I here? Why am I killing monsters that just spawn out of nowhere?
So the question, why do you role play? What I hear is that you are looking for that session again, kind of like on a crusade to find a good role playing session, right? A good role playing experience. And so you've been trying over the years, right? Is that fair to say?
Because after the role play session, you're what's the word? I don't want to use the word immersed. I don't like that word so much, but it's default. It happens automatically when mm-hmm. you role play. Mm-hmm. And after the game, you felt like you were really there. And it sticks to you. You remember it. You remember the characters. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You remember all of it.
The situation.
Like, I'm going to ask you a trick question. Do you still remember that game session? It was you and I think Andre and Aaron and who else? And you were fighting over the captain's briefcase, which was...
Oh, hand, yes, I remember. Hand, yes, I remember.
Handcuffed. And he gets his hand cut off anyway.
Oh wow, I remember that there was a lot of people on that set.
Everyone was grappling in that one scene there.
It was amazing, and a really good session.
I mean, to be funny though, I do you remember me pulling out the book to see how much damage that would be on his hand?
yeah, I remember that, but you know, it's been a long time.
I know, it was like 10 years, 12 years ago.
Yeah, easily. So, you know, that lead me to my first question, because, you know, coming up upon that, you know, I would say, I don't want to say frustration or maybe like, but this has some disappointment in the hubby sub, because sometimes you have those great sessions of true role play that you just described. And sometimes you have those endless, boring session where you don't get exactly what you want. And it's very hard kind of like to be constant in what you want. And that is a frustration that a lot of people have encountered over the years that we hear in the podcast world or in the vlogging world on YouTube, in the RPG community.
I had that frustration for the longest time. From like 1984 until 19... until 2004.
Yeah.
What is that? 20 years of frustration, because I didn't know what I had to do to get the role play to happen again.
And
I took that first session for granted that I role played in. I thought this is how it's always going to be. I didn't take any notes down how the guy ran his game. I never saw the guy again.
The deception must have been not deception, but I don't know how you guys say it in English when you are frustrated fooled. No, not tricked, but you know, when you are sad that it doesn't work the way you want it, you are...
Or disappointed?
Disappointment. Yeah, disappointment. The disappointment must have been amazing. You know, 20 years of disappointment, but...
Well, no, what I did, I left the hobby for 20 years. So I had other hobbies to do.
Yeah.
I was playing video games in the meantime.
But that, you know, that lead me to the first question. Because you actually kind of find a solution to that problem, and you ended up writing a book about role playing.
You're fast traveling. Remember, we met each other like 12 years ago on the internet, on YouTube.
Yes.
I had kind of sort of signed up with the RPG Brigade. I didn't consider myself a member of the brigade, but they did. So they added me into their group. About 3 months later, you showed up. And I remember your videos. You were talking about you came from Pathfinder. And you were looking for the magic. But like you, we didn't know what we were looking for, but we found the brigade. And from the brigade videos, we would do video responses and try out things on our own and get back and post our updates and what worked and what didn't work.
Oh, yes.
We bounced ideas off of each other back then.
Oh, man, those ideas? Because the thing is that I fast-tracked that part, but when I read the book, the last edition, I was like, man, it's kind of like a synthesis of so much of those conversations you and I had. I don't remember what we used for FaceTime back in the days, but video calls that we used to do,
it was either Skype or Google Hangouts.
Google Hangouts and stuff like that. And you and I had a lot of very, very long conversation that never were public, that were not live or, you know, posted as videos. So just private conversation.
Just face-to-face stuff.
So many ideas, so many frustration that we shared and discussed and in the video responses as well, like you mentioned. So of course, and like you said, I totally agree. I was looking for something, but I didn't know what I was looking for.
Yeah.
And the brigade kind of helped me realize what I liked and what I didn't like back then. Yes, for sure.
And plus we were learning other things too at that same time. We were learning how to be YouTubers. We were learning how to make videos, to film, how to edit.
Well, I never did any editing.
When we both started, we had lousy cameras and microphones. At least I did.
Oh, I always use my cell phone. I never been pro.
You never had like a laptop or anything?
Yes, nope. I had a laptop, but I had that, but the best camera were on the iPhone all the time.
Oh, that's true. That's still the case.
Yeah, still the case. Yeah.
iPhones are the best cameras on earth.
Yeah.
They do than just camera now.
So you kind of came up with what I find amazing with this idea that you had is like, okay, so you tell me if I'm wrong, but it feels like you wanted to put in a word some kind of a method or some kind of a style or some kind of an approach or methodology or protocol to have a good chance to reach that great role play experience. You kind of like to make sure that it happens all the time.
Yeah. Well, I needed help explaining it because every time I would go on someone's live stream, they would ask me, how do I role play? And then they'd argue with me because they don't understand what I'm talking about. And I got tired of re-explaining it over and over and over again from scratch every time I'm in a live stream. So I thought, I'll just write a book. And people can either read the book or not read the book. And then I don't have to explain it much anymore.
Ah, it's a relief. And do the work to put it in word actually make you make it better for yourself as well. You probably discover a lot of things just writing about it.
Oh yeah, I had to learn Grammarly. I had to learn how to use Scrivener, because I thought, you know, I'll just use Word or I'll just use Google Docs and type something. But I could never focus. I was messing around with the fonts, the spacing, the page numbers, the table of contents. I kept goofing around with the program. But when I got Scrivener, I could just type away my random thoughts and then organize them in like an outline. And then, and just make a PDF from the book and put it on drive-through.
Yeah. And so let me kind of ask you this question in a more direct way. So I read the book, the last edition of it. It's kind of short. It's 55 or something like that pages, 54.
Yeah.
Kind of. It's not a long read, and it's a great read because you write well, and it's very clear. So just want to say it right away. So when I was reading it, I was like, Jesus Christ, it is radical. I would argue that it's fair to say that it's radical in its approach to like table behaviors and social contract.
Yeah.
And so, but I want you to talk about it. So what do you mean first by the title, which is the hard way to play, or how to role play the hard way? And what does the acronym HARD stands for exactly?
Okay, I used to go to Barnes & Noble and look at the computer programming books. And they had a series of books like the Dummy books, the Learn Programming in 21 Day books. But they also had a series of books called Learn to Program the Hard Way. And I thought, that's a catchy title. Those books were expensive, but they didn't really teach much. But I still like the title. And then when I was writing, this is like 10 years later, I'm writing my book and I'm thinking, what should I call my book? And I thought, Role Play the Hard Way. And I went on the internet to see if someone's already written a book called Role Play the Hard Way. And no one had, so I snatched it. And it was just a tongue-in-cheek thing. You know, only people that were at bookstores or Amazon looking for computer books, they would see that title of mine and think, oh, this sounds like one of those programming books that are hard. They're hard to understand.
Yeah, it's catchy. I was
kind of being funny when I said hard.
Yeah.
And then inside it even had, I even came up with what hard stands for.
Mm-hmm.
Honest and reactive dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
That took about 3 seconds to figure out.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's like, how do I role play? What makes role play honest? You know, you trust your players at the table. You want players that are honest. Because I would hear this a lot. Or Shonner, if you let the players do whatever they want, they're going to cheat and ruin your game, and they're going to break your setting, and all this time, like, they're just going to open up a chest. Or they'll just go to their car and open up a trunk and pull out Uzis and start firing into, you know.
Yeah, the infamous, that's an argument from Runeslinger that he got from the Three Musketeers and the book from Alexandre Dumas. And I think it's the crowbar of someone. I don't remember the name of the guy. Because in the book, there is, I don't know if you know what I mean, but it's a scene where one of the musketeers trying to open the door, and the door is locked. Yep. And you kind of just pick up a crowbar that stands there and open the door with it. And so Alexandre Dumas himself in the Three Musketeers use that kind of device to, you know, create some kind of a hand of God effect. And I know that Runeslinger was a, you know, believes that it's kind of important to be a little bit more strict upon that kind of behavior. So you have that kind of approach as well. I hear the same very often, meaning that the player might gonna break the game if you give them too much agency.
Yeah, you know you trust that the players know the setting. They're not gonna have an atomic bomb when it's the medieval age. They're not going to have cars when there's no cars, you know, that kind of thing. I mean, mm-hmm. I tried it once in your game. My noble character, I don't think we had a car. And I just said, oh, my character walks across the street to the parking meter and slides his credit card through it and then waits. And no one else said anything. while I'm doing this, and then about what, a minute or two later, here comes this grav car, this limo. And we all got into the limo and we had a ride.
Yeah. And it's amazing. It was funny. It's
paid for with my credit card. It's something that could happen in that setting.
Yeah, it makes sense. And it's cool. It's easy going. It's fluid. But it's the idea of improvisation as well that comes into that. But it's part of the approach, though. Can you describe the methodology? Because basically role playing the hard way is kind of like a protocol or a method. So is it possible for you to kind of break it down, either step by step or the way you want to describe how it works?
Well, the way I describe it is just minimalistic role play. What that means is when it's the player's turn, they simply say where their character is, what their character is doing. You know, two sentences. Then someone else says where their character is and what their character is doing. And you go round robin at first. You just go round robin. That way everyone has a turn to say where their character is and what their character is doing. Now, what a character does could be anything from brushing their teeth, tying their shoes, watching the television, reading a newspaper, making breakfast, having a dialogue with somebody else in the room. And it keeps the players not so much honest, but it helps the players keep track of where everyone else is in the game. So when a player says, walk out of my car, shut the door, you know, walk to the house across the street, and I'm looking at the front door because it looks like it's ajar. As I get closer to the door, I slowly open it more and stick my head in the house and look around. Now that's like four turns right there that I described. But while I'm doing that, the other players are saying what they're doing. So I get out of my car and start walking across the street. That's my turn. So someone else says what they're doing. You know, maybe there's a kid in the house and they see me and they open the door a crack as I'm approaching. And then you hear the dad character yell, "What are you doing? Shonner's on his way over here." And that's when I say, I see the door is ajar, and I step closer. And then the kid character says, "Here comes Shonner. Daddy, Shonner's on his way." "Who? Get over here. Your soup's getting cold." And then that's when I stick my head in the door. And then I'll say, "Anyone home?" You know, joking, because I saw the kid open the door. But if each player role plays that way, I guess that would be called the hard way, because everyone's being honest and they're using reactive dialogue with each other. Mm-hmm. The players are all in character. No one says anything out of character. No one asks the GM questions. The players role play their characters. The person running the game role plays their characters, and we don't mix that. We don't have the runner role playing the player characters, and we don't have the players role playing the runner's characters. Just like with fudging dice, the runner doesn't fudge dice. The players don't fudge dice, because if you reverse that, right? If the runner gets to fudge dice, then the players get to fudge dice. If the runner role plays the player characters, then the players get to role play the runner's characters. You know, so we don't want to go in that direction because that's crazy talk. We we stay in our own lanes and we interact with each other that would make sense for our characters. Our characters all have motives, goals, secrets. Secrets are the best part that you keep from the other players until you bring it out at the end somewhere. But you want your character to have motives and goals. The goals can be long term, short term. You know, I need to go to the gas station. That's my goal right now. And a longer term would be, I want to be president of the universe. I mean, that could be a super, super long term goal. And then another goal would just be, I'm supposed to be at my own wedding tomorrow. And I have not met the bride yet. So that's a concern. That's a goal. That's a motive of some sort. You're curious to see what your future wife is going to look like, or your future ex-wife is going to look like, because this is a time travel game. And you're sort of trapped in a loop. You've been married like 3 times to the same person before, and she keeps getting murdered. But you don't know this. She doesn't know it, but there's a serial killer who keeps murdering her and then goes back in time and doesn't murder her. So she's still alive, so technically she's not murdered. How would someone go about figuring out that this is happening? That's my current quest right now as a player. That's my current quest.
So
I want to write an adventure mod about that, but I don't know how to do it. Not yet.
So you know, in the hard, let's call it the hard way, the hard way method, or the hard way style, or the hard way approach, has a strong emphasis on social contract.
Yes.
And it is.
You might remember that social contract. It's pretty old.
Of course, because I in part kind of wrote it.
I stuck that in there to be funny. And I say in the book, you know, make your own. There are many to choose
from. Yeah, exactly.
A lot of people are just copy pasting mine and using it.
Oh man, and it's based on one I produced back in the days. But it's really interesting. I don't utilize that anymore. I have another way to do it now.
Let's talk
about this one, because the one in the book, or just the idea in general of the social contract, because in order to produce the experience you just narrated, you gave us an example. Okay. Yeah. You gave us an example with a couple characters in a situation.
Yeah.
And in order to reach that level of immersion and in character play as character, you know, in character as character play, in order to reach that level, you need a very minimalistic approach to the social contract in order to deal with the mechanics. So the social contract becomes very thick, very deep, has a lot of rules to kind of respect, kind of contingencies. And it becomes something that is very, that's why I use the word radical. But it's very controlling in a sense of, we can give a couple examples. I will let you, you know, if you want, give an example of all the stuff that's are in it. But let's just by memory, what I remember is no cell phone. Since it's mostly for online gaming as well, you know, everyone needs earbuds, good internet connection, good camera, good mic. The player needs to know their rules. The GM needs to know his rules. Everybody stays in character all the time, so never mention the rules, never ask questions, create stuff. You know, there is kind of like a long list of, you know, contingencies that needs to be kind of respected in order for that experience that you just produced to really happen on a regular basis, you know, kind of like on.
And you remember the social contracts we talked about a decade ago, how other YouTubers would say, oh, that's stupid, you don't need a social contract.
Back in the days, you know, it was more the case. I think now it's more common. People, you know, utilize more social contract now than maybe 10 or 12 years ago. But it's still. I just want you to go over, you know, what it would look like for the hard way, because it's important to understand, like, that it's a hardcore method I would put it in that category. Would you agree that it's kind of hardcore, or kind of it's hard for real, in the sense
it's hard if
it's demanding. It's demanding.
Hard, it's hard. It looks hard if you've never done it before. But if you practice just a few half-hour sessions with somebody, mm-hmm. and discuss after each half-hour session, you know, discuss how it works so far, or if you understand it, what you're doing so far. This is how I vet players. After a few half-hour sessions, players, I find, can role-play without thinking about it. Because we've practiced, it's become a drill, and it's now automatic that a player does when it's their turn. Because mm-hmm. you've seen these guys that say they've been in the hobby for 20 years, and whenever it's their turn, they have a blank look on their face, like they've never been in a game before still. I don't know how to explain that.
I've seen that over the years, you know, when you watch games live on YouTube,
yeah,
and you can compare, you know, it used to be kind of impossible to do so, but now it's becoming public, so you can see the quality of role playing or the level of gaming or the quality of experience from different group. Yeah. It will always be a matter of taste, you know. So let's not make value judgment. You know, it's kind of obvious. To each his own. All right. Yeah. I just want to make it clear, at least for me, to each his own. So, you know, the hard way, it's to produce a certain kind of experience, you know, and if it's not for you, it's not for you. I mean, it's okay. Yeah. So it's not about it is better. And, you know, I don't want to put that in. I just want to make sure that we understand each other. No, I know that, you know, but I mean, for the audience, the people that listen, that might listen. Personally, I am not, you know, advocating that approach more than any other, you know, what you want to do. But if you want to have from my own experience, that if you want to have a serious, deep, role play heavy session, that method definitely works. It will produce good role play session in character most of the time. That's for sure. We did it in the past, I know. And when you read it, you understand why it will work. Because it is so tight in terms of conditions, right?
Yeah. A lot of people criticize the book, but they haven't read it, though. They just assume, oh, these are LARPers. These are actors. These are people using voice acting. These are storytellers. They have a script that they're following. They think of everything but role play. I don't understand it, but it's a community. It's the RPG community thing that they do.
I don't know. I know what I know is that it is the thing with the hard way to play that you propose in the book. It's a solution to a certain form of frustration or a certain form of disappointment that many of us have encountered in this hobby. And so some of us, and what you did is good work. And I would say it's good work. It provides some kind of a solution. This is the way you can solve that. If you're willing to sacrifice a lot of stuff, you know, because a lot of people like to like the beer and pretzel format. Because you crack jokes, you drink alcohol, you eat chips, and everybody's have fun and laughing out loud and in and out of character all the time. It's no problem. It's just a big happening. It's a great way to role play. No one, you know, for sure. But if you want something that is more, you know, heavy, always in character, immersion proofed, if I might say, you know,
you're guaranteed immersion.
Will work. Oh yes, yeah. It will work. Can you describe some example of a good social contract that will allow that?
Well, only talk
according to the method.
Only talk in character during the game.
Yeah.
When it's your turn, just say where your character is, what your character's doing. Now, after a while, you don't have to keep saying where your character is all the time. Everyone knows where you are. You're in the car waiting for your ex-girlfriend to finish packing. She wants you to take her to the airport. So you've been waiting in the car for 10 minutes. So you don't have to keep saying, I'm in the car waiting. But you can be doing something else in the car, like listening to the radio, changing the dials on the knob, rolling the windows down, looking at your watch, texting her on your phone, and she's like, I'm almost done.
There's a lot of room. There's a lot of room for proactivity coming from the player. A lot of room for descriptions and narration coming from the player. Same for improvisation coming from the player. So it is also a demanding way to play, in the sense of if you a session, a 3-hour session, will be in terms of energy, when you are always in character, always engaged, always proactive, you know, never on your cell phone. You know, after a couple hours, you are
5 hours. Well, I don't know if you were in all of my games, but I did 5-hour games, and afterwards I'm emotionally drained.
Oh man.
But it's usually cool. It's so cool though.
I did that approach with you on Traveler back in the days, but I also did it with Mage the Ascension. And I had a lot of solo session that was lasting, let's say, an hour 15. And it was the best. Super intense, super immersive. And if it's short, like an hour and a half max, the intensity stays strong, you know, because you know it's going to be short anyway. So it's just a big experience that lasts for an hour and a half. And you're like, oh, man, one-on-one solo session kind of thing.
Yeah, even a 10-minute session, I'll remember that forever.
Of course, if it's good.
I remember every session I role played in, I remember.
Another thing that is important with this method, that is, I would consider the hardest part, is the part where you have kind of like to keep the mechanic to yourself. And so what it demands as a group is to get used to let everybody kind of like do the math in their head and never say the numbers. So everybody's looking at the number on the dice. They make the math in their head. So there's no pollution of the immersion with profane vocabulary, you know, that comes from the book or that comes from the math of the system or whatever. So it demands as well that everybody's kind of like do the calculation and the arithmetic in their head. So everybody's kind of like needs to understand from the dice instead of someone saying it works, it doesn't work, fail, success, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So that's kind of hard as well, just in and of itself. In and of itself, it's forcing yourself not to talk about it, kind of thing.
Yeah, there's different layers there, because when it's your turn, you first think, am I going to need to roll before I open my mouth? Okay, let's say I think I'm going to roll for something here. What should I roll? So you think backwards. You think of your turn going backwards, and then you say what your turn is. So I have my gun. I'm checking to see if there's a bullet in the barrel. Or I don't know anything about guns, but my character does. So I'm checking my gun to see if it's loaded. And I aim it at the dummy that's in the target range room from the locker room. I'm just going to shoot my gun from my locker room instead of be in the target range room and see if I can hit that dummy hanging from the wall. Wait, you know, 150 yards away. You know. Now, before I narrate my character doing this, I have to think also, okay, now what skill am I going to have to use when I do the roll? And what modifiers do I need to have added to my role before I even mention this? Because you don't want to be doing the math, wasting everyone's time doing the math before you say what you do, and then you sit there for 10 minutes trying to figure out, okay, now what do I have to roll to do what I just said I'm going to do? I prefer the players to already know in advance what they're going to roll. They already know a difficulty from me. or they can do it themselves. You know, shooting something 50 yards away is difficult with a pistol. It's not average. It's not easy. Some people complain if I have players rolling without me asking for a roll. They'll just roll. They're so immersed, and they know I'm going to say something about a roll, and they already have the roll in their head, what they have to do. They'll just go and roll. And then they'll honestly report back how the bullet ricocheted and missed, or they totally hit the they got a critical success and they managed to make the dummy come off the wall after shooting it or something. They'll describe that. And in the social contract, we agree or not who describes the failures and the successes for the players. Is that the runner or is that the player? And that comes up often, depending on the tone and the mood of the game session we're going to be in. Because some players like to narrate their own insanity rather than being told by the runner how insane they're going.
You know, it's even though it is very, you know, interesting and that, you know, from experience, I know that it can work. The thing that comes to me right away when I hear all this is that it leaves a lot of room for interpretations and a lot of room for misunderstanding and kind of like people not understanding exactly what it means. I'll give you an example, you know, and I'm playing devil's advocate. It's important because it's not perfect. Nothing is perfect in this hobby for many reasons, but this method doesn't escape it. For me, let's say, for example, I roll for myself and I know exactly, you know, the numbers that I need to do, you know, to calculate the distance, you know, the damage and all that. So I do it I'm a player. I roll the dice. I do it in my head. I don't talk about it. The only way people will see the number of the dice, if it's at the table, everybody see my dice. If it's online, I can use a dice roller that everybody sees, or, you know, I can show it with the camera, or, you know, just, it doesn't matter. Let's say,
it doesn't matter to me.
It doesn't matter, exactly, because you will interpret by the narration how good it was.
Right.
So, exactly, and that leaves a lot of room for misunderstanding. Some people will see a critical success a certain way. Some people will see just a normal success a certain way. They want to embellish and make it even bigger just for the fun and the sake of it. And so, you know, it can create this room where people, and if you have problem following the game, and I know you have to be strict in the hardware. You need to follow. But let's say you have a little bit problem following the game and then you don't know, did he pass? Did he fail? Because nobody talks about the number. Nobody talks about the rule. Is it my turn? Where we are exactly? And so it can lead to these kind of situations sometimes.
Yeah, like the guy with the gun, he could have a gun that's super advanced. The bullets go through concrete, go through steel. And he says, I aim at the dummy figure hanging on the wall way at the far end of the shooting range, and I fire. And sometimes the player doesn't bother to roll. Not only do they hit the dummy, the bullet goes through the dummy, knocks out the wall, hits the house in the alley, across the alley behind the building, you know, through their backyard, through their fence, bullet goes through their kitchen. Out and goes through their car, goes through their house, through the car parked in their driveway, something like that. And you would just assume that's what the gun does every time he shoots. He didn't have to roll for anything because it's like a super, super dangerous gun that he has. And he's just letting the other characters know what his gun can do.
I understand.
It's sort of like a storytelling narrative kind of
thing. I understand it.
Like someone could have asked, hey, what kind of gun is that? I've never seen one of those before. And then I shoot it and and describe.
Yeah,
and describe
just like anything, I think that that this approach, this hard way method, is something that every group needs some use to. And I'm sure after a couple of sessions, it goes very well and it's very fluid, because it creates what it's good. What it's good for is to create a collective imagination. Everyone is in the same situation, utilizing their imagination. Because when you stay in character all the time, that's what it creates. It creates that you talk to each other in character. It's not the player talking to the player and then going in character and then going back into player and character again. It's just character all the time. So eventually it becomes just a fluid conversation of characters and situations.
That's my goal, is to be fluid. Mm. But typically I'd say between 89-92% of the game is fluid. And then there's always that part where,
yeah,
you know, someone goes out of character for a while because they're confused about something. And but it doesn't really matter, because it's going to be their turn again soon anyway. They'll figure out a way. They'll realize what's happening, where they should be in the setting, and get caught up. Okay, I see. They're all hanging on the back of the dump truck that's going towards a cliff or something.
Yeah, and it's not that hard. I was listening to a Runeslinger's podcast today, and one of the podcaster that called, I don't remember his name, I think it's Jason, he said that it's not that hard to go in and out of immersion. You know, a lot of people are talking about like it's important to keep immersion and all that, and I agree, but it's not that hard to go in and out of it. Especially when you're used to fact. So if you utilize the hard way, and you spend, you said 85% in character, well, it's very good. 85% for a 3 hour session, it's interesting.
How many times would you normally roll in a game like that, do you think? For me, it's each player rolls maybe twice in an hour. And if you have five players, that's 10 rolls in an hour.
Yeah, it sounds legit. I mean,
some people take longer to roll and calculate in their head than others.
Also, now let's address the elephant in the room, is that this method, as minimalist as it is, as demanding as it is in terms of social contract and you know, habits and stuff that players should do in such a session, it is not good with all system. You know, there is some games just by design will not work with this approach. Can you give an example of what a very good game is for that and what a very bad game is for that?
I guess I call it a first generation game, and that would be Dungeons and Dragons. It's not the greatest. It's not really a role-playing game. You want to start with a role-playing game first before you try to do anything the hard way. D&D is more of a board game, war game. The players have armies, but their army is just one unit. And they go around in a dungeon killing stuff. It could be role-played. I think you yourself said you could role-play in Dungeons and Dragons. People have said it. I was in a game. I was in a game back in 1979. It was a D&D game, and it was role-played. So I know it can be done. But you have to have a dungeon master that wants to do it that way. And the game goes against you because of all the charts and looking up stuff in the book. You want to have a game system that you don't have to look in the book during the game. If a question comes up during a game, save it for later. After the session, that's when you bring up the questions you had during the session. Until then, the person running the game just comes up with a ruling on the fly, and they can check it later to see if it's a good ruling or if it was terrible, or if the rules are totally different than what the ruling was, or if it's almost the same as what. Because there's so much going on in the game. There's no point really questioning the minor fiddly stuff. Because you're going to be too busy role-playing something else in the next scene. And you won't probably remember the question you had an hour or two ago.
Mm-hmm. So a good game would be, anything old school Renaissance that is minimalist. Anything that is light on combat.
You want a game that's less board gamey.
Yeah. Exactly.
And you want a game system that
rule light,
medium rule light, and skill based. The skills make sense for the theme and the setting.
Simple task resolution.
And you can customize your character based on your character's career or your character's skills. Mm-hmm. So you can customize a character that you know you can role play really well, mm-hmm. that you're familiar with. It doesn't have to be sci-fi. It doesn't have to be fantasy. It could be cybernetics. It could be.
Oh, it can be anything.
It could be contemporary. I prefer a lot of my games are just contemporary because that's what I use to teach new players is contemporary because that's the setting they know.
It is a genre agnostic. You know, in the sense of it doesn't matter. You can apply this to all. I would say any game that is based on the same kind of structure that Traveller, World of Darkness, very simple task resolution mechanic. Combat is light, skill based, like you said.
Call of Cthulhu is another second game.
Yes, you can do it. Yeah.
And then, do you know my theories about the different generations of RPGs? Did I ever tell you that?
The first
gen, second gen, third gen. I know we talked about this like so many.
But there is something else that I want to talk about. But
it's real quick.
Let's finish with the question.
You go first.
Yeah, because now we said what the best was. What would be the worst in your book kind of game? To utilize the hard way. Right away, I would say Burning Wheel, because Burning Wheel has too much meta gaming and meta systems and rules.
Is it a lot like Fiasco? Because I was going to say Fiasco.
No, Fiasco has nothing to do with the hard way. You know, the Fiasco is a.
That's why I was saying that would be the hardest to do the hard way with.
But it doesn't make sense. I would say so. It's not even relevant. It's not even relevant. I would talk about a game that would make sense to utilize, but it doesn't work. It would say anything that is based on the Genesis system from Fantasy Flight.
Really?
Yeah, because you have to interpret the dice. So you roll the dice, and you have to talk about the dice. Second edition, you could not use the hard way because you have to talk about, you know, how you put the points in the dice pool of your dice after the roll. So you have a layer of discussion of how you interpret the result in between the resolution. Yeah. So it doesn't work. It would not work. 7C, second edition, and games like Burning Wheel, all that.
Dungeon Crawl Classics has the points. So does Savage Worlds has Benny points.
Yeah, stuff like that. Yeah.
Conan has the dread points or something.
Yeah.
Momentum points.
You know, it could work. It could work, but it would just be a little slower.
You'd have to tweak the hard way to make it work with your game.
Yeah, exactly. As long as this is where you see that you are, you know, pushing it. When you have to tweak stuff, you know, usually it's a good sign. For me, at least for me, that you could use another game. You could use another, a better game to do it.
Another really good game that works with the hard way is the Total Party Skills system.
Oh, that doesn't know about it.
It's very simple. You can role play with the thing. Mm. Yeah, it's on drive-through. It's called Total Party Skills. They have all different kinds of. They have a vampire. They have a werewolf. It's different genres.
That's interesting, and so, in your perspective, who do you think this book and this method is for? you know, what kind of individual would be interested in, you know, reading that book?
I guess it would be
and somebody, utilizing the method. At least give it a try.
Somebody who maybe has seen role players on YouTube. Maybe some good ones. They looked out and they saw some good players. And then they'd see me on YouTube talking about, hey, I got this book in the description down below. It's free. And that player, that future role player, will download the book and read it and understand it because they've never role played before. And it all makes sense to them. Now, if there's somebody who's been playing D&D for 30 years, they won't understand any of what I'm saying. Or they'll say, this is what they usually say. Oh, Shonner is just talking about stuff we do already in our games. This is just common knowledge. Yeah, it's just, you know, that's the answer I get from those guys. Mm. But yet, when I watch their videos, I don't see any of the hard role play happening in any of their games. No, I'll bring it up. I'll bring it up too. And they
here is my question that I want to kind of wrap up the discussion with. When we talk about this interview together, we had a chat and you shared me some videos. And we've been talking about the hard way of role playing, you know, for an hour now. Exactly. And we did not describe what you mean by role play, because a lot of people think that the beard pretzel, laughing out loud, cracking joke, going in and out of character is role playing, because you play a role playing game still, right? Yeah. But now here what we're talking about is the layers of being in character as character, first person. So really role playing, so embodying a character. Now, you recently talked to me about the new lingo that's been around in the RPG community, which is 1D, 2D, 3D, and 4D role playing. And I see that a lot and more by the day now, since you talked to me about that. And a lot of people a lot of vloggers and podcasters sort of throw those ideas out there. So, oh, this is 2D role playing, this is 3D role playing, 4D role playing. Yeah. Can you break it down for us? You know, what you mean by role playing, and where do you locate it in that 1D, 2D, 3D, 4D? How do you, you know, position yourself toward that?
A 1D player is somebody who sits at the table and doesn't say a word during the game session. They just sit there quietly while the Dungeon Master plays a solo RPG.
Yeah, a very passive player, for example.
And he's reading, the GM's reading from his adventure book, and he sees there's a roll that needs to be made. So he'll pick someone from the table to make a roll. Mm. And they roll the dice and they say, I rolled a 7. So the GM then reads what happens next in the story.
Yeah.
That's a 1D game. Mm-hmm. 2D game is when the GM reads a page from the book and then says to the players, what do you guys do? And the guys all say, can my character do this? Is my character allowed to do this? Is it possible I can try doing this? Does my character know about so-and-so in this world? Is there treasure around? Can I check for traps?
Mother may I. The 2D is the mother may I. He's asking, he's engaged, he's active, but he's not affirmative. He's always asking permission to do things and asking questions to validate his ideas and stuff like that. 2D. Okay.
And let's say no matter what they say, the GM says, make a roll. Okay. Right. I rolled a 13. Okay. So you found a trap. You found a trap door. What do you want to do? And then they'll say, well, what does the door look like? What is it made of? Can my character now open the door? Is it locked on the other side? That mother may I stuff goes on for days in these game sessions. I can't watch them for too long. But I'm told, hey, Shonner, watch our game. We role played. I'm like, okay. And then I get upset when there's no role play. But the 2D GM, what they'll do is no matter what the role is, the GM says, okay, so your character's checking for traps, and this is what happens, and now you're doing this. You're going inside the trap door, and you're looking around for treasure. Or the trap door cuts you in half, and now you're bleeding to death.
So the GM is basically describing everything about everything. The character.
Yeah, the 2D GM describes all of it. The players are just there.
To roll the dice, to ask questions, and move a little bit around.
Yeah. Now the 3D player, there is no what do? It's all in character from everybody. The GM narrates the location. You guys are in the Temple of Doom. That's it. The players kind of make up what might be in the Doom Temple. One of them grabs a torch, lights up the thing. They can see in the Temple of Doom. They're walking around. They're saying where they're at, what they're doing. They don't say, can my character use his torch to see in the dark with? Does my character have a sword? You know, my fighter barbarian, does he have a sword? Does my thief have thief skills? You know, none of that stuff. Everyone knows their character inside and out. They can role play in character. They're doing things that their character would normally do. And they can add stuff to the scene if it makes sense that it would be there. Like I pick up a rock and I throw it at the Cyclops. Mm-hmm. Instead of saying, is there a rock I can pick up?
Yeah. So the 3D player... starts to improv stuff for and describe and narrate stuff of his own, and stays in character.
Doesn't have to ask for permission.
Doesn't ask permission, and the GM stick to locations and NPC.
And the GM just narrates what happens.
Yeah,
not what the characters do. He's not moving them from room to room. Okay, you guys go down the dark hallway, and you're now in the crypt room. Now The GM is more like a referee. He or she just sits there and listens to the player's role play. And he'll blurt out something like, oh, maybe have a NPC nearby. And the NPC can mention the difficulty of this location. Anything you do, any skill checks are going to be difficult or easy. Or, oh, this is so easy. When an NPC will say, oh, this is going to be so easy. We got this. That's letting the players know any roles they make are automatic super easy.
I see. So that's the 3D approach.
Yeah.
Okay. So what could be the 4D?
4D? That's when you invite your other self into the game, which would be, I have a manservant with me. Or you invent... You don't have a car, but now you do. You don't have a place to live. Oh, I'm on the east side. I have a penthouse up on the east side. You make up stuff. You are what do they call it? You're helping build the setting.
The GM. Because I thought that you did that in the 3D that you just described. That's why I.
Oh, the 3D is more like the player just saying what they do, like pick up a rock and throw it at the site.
Okay, so they don't ask. They don't do world building. So in the 3D, they just do. Yeah, they do stuff by improvising and creating a few things in the
little things. Yeah. If they're in the forest.
Yeah, but they will not do world building. You know, exactly in the forest they'll find a tree branch. They don't invent
that they have a sister who's the queen and she's gonna send guys that
okay now that's 4D. Okay, I see.
Yeah, 4D is when you say I have an army waiting outside. It has to make sense that your character would have an army
of course.
in 4D. In my opinion, in the hard way, technically I merge 3D and 4D together, and I call that the hard way. Mm. Some people have split it up and made 3D and 4D separate things. It's just one extra layer of hardness, but there isn't much jump between 3D and 4D. It's not much of a leap.
Yeah.
Once you do 3D, it's easy to do 4D.
Exactly. That's what I was. That's why you see exactly because that's why we. I was kind of confused in the difference. What's the difference? It's nuance. Yeah, the 4D is world building. For 4D, everybody creates lore. It's a collective lore creativity, thing.
In a 4D game, the GM creates 50% of the world, and then the players create the other 50%. So if there's like five players in the game, then they create 10% each.
Yeah.
About the world. Something that makes sense. They don't do all the creation. They don't take all that away from the GM. The GM still has 50%.
Of course. But it's interesting because, I hear often when I'm listening to a lot of podcasts, I hear a lot of people having a lot of problem talking about their prep and finding that GM anxiety and GM burnout.
What is prep?
And it's very cool because the hard way, one of the great things with the hard way, even though it's demanding and it's very controlling, it's still... something, it's less work for the GM. It's crazy how it becomes GM light in a way.
If the GM has no characters, then there's hardly anything the GM does except be a referee.
Exactly. It's kind of just refereeing and reacting to the players, and the players are doing most of the job. And it's very cool.
Describes the weather. Daytime, nighttime, is there atmosphere?
Yeah.
Is there lava?
And then the GM will do the logistic, when it's a combat situation or when everybody wants to talk at the same time. Sometimes you need the GM just to do the taking turns and stuff like that. So listen, I wanna put it to an end. But before we leave, can you just describe the book? What's the title? Where they can find it? What they can get out of it quickly? And where they can find you as well, either, your address or your YouTube channel, if they want to, get in touch with you or have more information about it.
Yeah, the book is called How to Role Play the Hard Way. I am... youtube.com/Shonner. That's my YouTube channel.
All right. Also, I want to mention that the book is completely free.
Yep.
It's around 50 page. It's good quality. It's well written. The example, especially the last edition that I read recently, all the example you give are clear. It's well put. When you describe how it works and you put some, just like in a core book, you put like an example of a role play example.
Yeah.
Man, that helps to understand so much. So I think it's a great product. It's free and it's easy to read and it's easy to implement in a game. If you want to try, anyone wants
and,
to try.
And lots of people have read it and they contact me and they ask me questions about things and they're trying it out right now with their own groups.
Yeah, that's cool. Oh, thank you very much, Shonner. It was a great conversation.
It was good talking with you again.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I see you around.
Have a good day.
Have a good day.